Welcome. Let me begin this evening's webinar by wishing everyone a very Merry Christmas and happy and healthy New Year. May you all enjoy spending time with family and friends. I also want to welcome our two very special guests, General Wesley Clark and Dr. Phillip Karber, who will address us this evening as to the current situation in Ukraine and the danger posed by continued aggression by Russia and the massive buildup of Russian troops, hardware, equipment, and weapons on the borders of Ukraine. The relationship which exists between the United States of America and Ukraine, as reinforced by the renewed Charter on Strategic Partnership in November of 2021, accentuates the principles and values which bind democratic states. The overall objective of strategic partners is the pursuit of peaceful coexistence within the norms of international order. Current aggressive actions on Ukraine's border by the Russian Federation exemplifies Putin's lawless disregard of the territorial integrity, sovereignty, and independence of a neighboring country, while subjugating the world on a precipice of war. We, the Ukrainian Congress Committee of America, the representative organization of nearly 2 million Americans of Ukrainian descent, remain extremely alarmed with the escalation of Russian troops and military hardware on Ukraine's borders. Such Kremlin exploits precipitated a video call last week between Ukrainian community leaders in the world, in which I and the UCCA Executive Vice President participated with the President of Ukraine. In addition, this past Friday morning, at the initiation of Senator Rob Portman, President Zelensky held a video conference call jointly with a bipartisan group of 15 U.S. senators and 10 members of the U.S. House of Representatives. President Zelensky loudly and clearly defined the critical situation, the priorities, and the needs to deter the Russian aggressor. The Ukrainian American community since 2014 has consistently and rightfully called upon the U.S. officials to enact severe ramifications for the Kremlin's invading forces, hybrid warfare, and illegal occupation of Crimea and eastern Ukraine. Measures including sanctions of Russian financial, energy, defense, and manufacturing sectors, the removal of Russia from the SWIFT international financial system, stopping the Nord Stream 2 political pipeline, providing additional military assistance to Ukraine to defend against Russian forces, shortening the approval time for delivery of military assistance, as well as embracing the 2008 NATO Bucharest Summit that ensured that Ukraine will become a member of the Security Alliance, are all clear objectives that can and would stifle Russia's malign behavior towards Ukraine. Since the dissolution of the Soviet Union officially 30 years ago today, Russia has touted Ukraine as being existential to its statehood. Its falsification of Ukraine as a failed state is indicative of an authoritarian regime designed to keep that country in its orbit, and thus stymie the further expansion of NATO to Russia's borders. We at the UCCA are grateful to the United States Congress that has heard the appeals of the Ukrainian American community and enacted bold and decisive legislative initiatives on an overwhelming bipartisan basis. Such commitments to Ukraine from the United States must manifest itself fully in continued support for the territorial integrity, sovereignty, and independence of Ukraine. The Ukrainian Congress Committee of America will continue to lead and advance this effort until Ukraine is once again whole and free. Peace in the world is dependent upon resolute measures to stop Russia's aggressive behavior. As a united community, we must continue to be engaged with the administration and the U.S. Congress. I call on all of you to do your part. We look forward to the presentations by our esteemed speakers. Merry Christmas, Veselik Svyat, Shchaslivogo Novogo Roku, and Slava Ukraini.
All right, we are all here. Greetings, everybody. Thank you, President of UCCA, Andriy Futey, for welcoming us here today. For those of you who could not get onto the Zoom, or you know friends who did not receive a Zoom link, you can find this video being streamed on UCCA's Facebook and UCCA's YouTube page. Since those are being live streamed, if you miss something, you can always go back to the video later on. Without further ado, many of you saw this posting on social media and saw that we have two distinguished speakers, as Andriy Futey mentioned. Additionally, we have our good Vice President, Michael Sawkiw, with us as well, who will be speaking with us later on. But I would like to get straight to the presentations first and foremost. So first, we have speaking with us today, Dr. Phillip Karber. For those of you who haven't had the pleasure or the wonder of seeing one of Dr. Karber's presentations, I'll just go over his biography for you. He is first and foremost the president of the Potomac Foundation. He is internationally recognized as an expert in defense and national security. A graduate of Pepperdine University, he has a PhD from Georgetown, and he served in the U.S. government as a strategy advisor to the Secretary of Defense, reporting directly to him and the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. In addition to his credentials, I think the one thing many of us value more than anything is the fact that Dr. Karber has visited the front line of Ukraine more than probably any expert that has spoken with government officials in this country or any other country. And that combined with our other speaker, the distinguished General Wesley Clark, you have a wealth of visits to Ukraine that we're gonna be able to directly ingest some information, digest it, and then process at the end with Michael as to how we can get this information out to the people who will be making a difference. Dr. Karber, I don't need to speak any more than you. So I will turn the floor over to you, and we are welcome to have you with us. Let me unmute you. I'm sorry, I muted you for the opening video there. If you can just unmute there and spotlight you for everybody. There we go. There we go. Thank you.
Are we there? Okay.
You're good. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. We titled this Warning of War because it's an interesting time and a challenge. 8 years ago, General Clark and I were asked by the U.S. Congress to provide a report. We'd been invited to the Ukrainian front by the Ukrainian government in March, April of 2014. And we gave a report that summer to a three-hour joint session of Congress. And recently we were asked to redo it again. So this is a work in progress because we're just It's literally a moving train in terms of what's going on. But we thought you might want to hear a sort of progress report of where things seem to be at this time, and also some of the uncertainties. Why call it a warning of war? As you see, I borrowed from St. Matthew, you shall hear the war of wars and rumors of wars. But what's interesting is in my 50 years in Washington, I cannot remember of a situation or time when a U.S. administration has so publicly articulated the fear of an impending attack by another power on a friend of the United States, and gone to such lengths about highlighting it and making a big deal about it. And so there are all these indications. On the other hand, there's also a number of uncertainties. It's interesting, I went back and looked the last time that there was a force massing from the east this large was the 1961 Berlin crisis. But unfortunately, there's an asymmetry today because we in the West are not doing what President Kennedy did in 61, which was counter with massive U.S. reinforcement to Europe and mobilization of NATO. So this is some of the issues. It's important when people sort of talk about, there might be an invasion of Ukraine, or there might be a war against Ukraine. So I want to emphasize this. No, there is a war against Ukraine. It's been going on for 8 years, and it has been a Russian-led invasion. And that invasion has been extremely costly to Ukraine, not only in lives, seriously injured, more than a million people displaced. But it's interesting, of 8 years, Ukraine has lost the equivalent of 2 years' GDP in the loss of Crimea, the Donbass, and the cost of the war. It's a massive hit on a country that's trying to develop. So it's important to remember this slide, that the battle and fighting is continuing. There's a number of open issues, and we'll give you our best estimate of where things are tonight, but it's by far not conclusive. For example, why is Russia doing this, and particularly why now? There's no apparent trigger for this. Was it just an impulsive moment and Putin, he woke up in a bad mood and said, what the hell? Or is this part of a premeditated strategy? There's been talk about the potential for invasion being 175,000 troops and 100 battalion tactical groups, but was only about 100,000 right now on the border and about only 50 to 60 battalion tactical groups. So the question is, is that enough, or is the other force still coming? And if so, when and where are they coming from? And how would they be orchestrated into an attack? Likewise, this buildup is actually a toot azimuth around Ukraine, which was, for the last 8 years, we've all been focused on the war in the Donbass, a frontage of about 600 kilometers. But if you take in the Russian activities in Crimea, the Black Sea, the Sea of Azov, then to the north of the Donbass, opposite Kharkiv, opposite Chernigov, and then coming out of Belarus, that front has now been extended five times to 3,000 kilometers, which is an enormous frontage to try to defend against, even for the best of militaries. There's also an interesting question about is it just a matter of military force, or are there missing elements that are yet to fall in play that we're still waiting to see? And also, how pressured are the Russians? Are they in a use or lose position? That is, because of the winter and the high cost and difficulty of keeping troops out in frozen ground in the middle of winter. Is this something that they either get it done soon, or if they're in negotiations and the negotiations are prolonged for weeks, months, will they keep that force sitting there on edge? And as General Clark, I'm sure, will point out, the longer troops are sitting there waiting out in the field, that edge tends to get dull. So there is sort of an end date at which some of their options may be foreclosed. But that also raises the question, depending on what size and where this attack might come from, how long can Ukraine hold on? So these are some of the issues we'll sort of lead to, and then briefly end with some comments about Ukraine's role and strategic importance to us and to European security. Putin's made a big emphasis about, what happened at the end of the Cold War. So it's worth sort of starting where he is starting and sort of call it like we see it rather than purely by his narrative. So this shows essentially NATO corps lined up. There were nine of them in West Germany against five Russian armies. First Guards Tank, Second Guards Tank, Third Shock, Eighth Guards, and 20th Army, plus groups of forces in Poland, Czechoslovakia, and Hungary. Behind that was a second echelon of an additional group of armies, additional 10 armies that would be the follow-on forces or could be sent mobilized ahead of time for a massive invasion of Europe. With the end of the Soviet Union, those five armies in East Germany, which were the ones immediately deployed opposite us and were the highest readiness and the most well-equipped, they and the other groups of forces went home. And then with the breakup of the Soviet Union, so that came with the fall of the wall. With the breakup of the Soviet Union, then the Baltic republics didn't want anybody, any Russian troops or units in their area. So the Russians moved those forces into Kaliningrad, and Belarus and Ukraine inherited large Russian inventories of forces, but couldn't afford to keep them up. So gradually they were basically, most of that was either sold off or disbanded. So that was sort of the situation that Russia faced. Given their collapse, essentially, the Russian economy and their military, for 15 years, their military was in deep trouble. Since 2014, they realized, if I go back to the previous slide, you'll notice how few forces were actually along the Ukrainian border. So when in 2014, the current confrontation started, Russia had to basically bring forces in and around. So they brought the 20th Guards Army down opposite Eastern Ukraine, then recreated the 1st Guards Tank Army, then recreated the 8th Guards Army, and also armed the two separatist corps and also created corps in Crimea. So they were building up this substantial force in opposite Ukraine. This is what's happened since 14. So this shows the force levels that existed right at the beginning of 2014, how much was added then and how much is now coming on in 2021. So it's sort of interesting when one looks at it and one says, well, wait a minute, a lot of that stuff was already there this year. So why are we calling this a significant buildup? And it's an honest, legitimate question to address. And I'll go through it. Part of the reason is some of these units were manned at low level. Some of them had just been moved, so they were not fully equipped, and their concerns and so forth were not fully developed. A number of them were still having relatively a high number of conscripts. In the Russian army, they still are dependent on conscripts for about 50% of their troops. And what they found in the Chechen wars was that conscripts are not well-trained, not well-motivated. They don't do well in combat. They take disproportionate casualties, and their mothers complain when they get killed. So one of the innovations of Putin in the Second Chechen War was to leave the conscripts at home and basically take only a piece of the brigade or the unit, what was called a battalion, which is an integrated battalion of artillery, infantry, and armor, and have that all filled out with professionals and leaving the conscripts in the rear area or in the supply trains. So that was sort of the reason why some of this force was not, it was there, but not necessarily fully up in man. Likewise, the 1st Donetsk Corps and the 2nd Luhansk Corps which are named after the two people's republics of the separatists. There's about 33,000 troops in those two corps, plus another 4,000 or 5,000 Russian advisors. So, and some of those are locals, and some of them are Chechen mercenaries, and some of them are Wagner Group, and a number of other sundry people who are getting paid to be there. What's interesting in changes this year is the run-up to the Zapad 2021. Zapad is the, in Russian, it's West. It's the traditional exercise the Soviets ran for an invasion of NATO. After the end of the Cold War, the Zapad exercises ceased. But when Putin came back to power in 1999, guess what? The Zapad exercises came back. Now, it's interesting. Putin was saying, oh, gee, NATO shouldn't have any forces forward. This is a recent claim, should not have any forces forward since move everything back to status quo ante of 1997, before the Baltics, for example, were even members of NATO. And you go, wait a second. This guy was preparing the largest post-war exercise, moving literally tens of thousands of Russian troops into Belarus and practicing an invasion of the Baltics, and also exercising the use of nuclear weapons, and just for sheer fun, as part of the exercise, ran a simulated 1 megaton hit nuclear weapon on Warsaw. So this was not a matter of NATO sort of gratuitously and aggressively moving east. The Russians did more than enough behavior to sort of provoke and have many of the newly independent states who are relatively militarily weak requesting help from NATO and wanting to be a part of NATO. There were similar Zapad exercises in 2009, again with the exercise of nuclear weapons. And then in 2013, a very interesting version of it was more of a hybrid campaign. So roughly half the forces that were involved were a Ministry of the Interior, were police troops, even some local mafiosos and gangs were recruited to play as a non-organized side of the exercise, which was sort of their practice of a hybrid front end to a major campaign. And then, of course, the scenario itself tended to fit what happened in 2014. After the war had been going on for 3 years, the Russians in 2017 ran another very large exercise, but this time now with these large armies that had been brought back, specifically the First Guards Tank Army, which came from Russia and moved into Belarus and practiced invading the Baltics, specifically Latvia and Lithuania, to open a land corridor to Kaliningrad. A very aggressive major exercise. Russians also ran exercises in 2018, which was a huge exercise in the central military region, which presumed that a hybrid campaign like had been in 2013 failed and had to be rescued by the armies, which was an interesting construct. And then also in the south, they ran campaigns against Kavkaz in the Black Sea and in Crimea. So they were scheduled for Zapad. And how did that come about? Well, in September of last year, 2020, Putin and Lukashenko, president of Belarus, publicly announced that they were going to get together and integrate their two forces. Already the air defenses were integrated. Russians were pushing much more for the Belarusian participation and work with the Russian forces. And so they announced they were going to bring their two forces together. In December, it was the Belarusians, not the Russians, who announced that there was going to be a big exercise called Zapad 2021, which was going to test this integration. But it wasn't just about testing their integration, it was testing their capabilities all across the front, not just against Ukraine, but against NATO. So in January and February, there was a big part of early preliminary supply exercise against the Baltics with airborne naval infantry, aircraft and ships against both NATO and neutrals in the Black Sea, but playing in the Baltic. Then in March and April, all of a sudden there was a buildup in the south opposite Ukraine. First in Crimea, bringing forces from the southern military region with heavy artillery, in fact, nuclear-capable artillery, into Crimea, along with airborne units were brought from all over Russia into Crimea, and heavy reinforcement there. And then, as a second phase, bringing reinforcements from Central Asia into the border opposite eastern Ukraine. So this is how that looked in the spring, if you look at it here, the black lines. And people were worried, and no doubt. What was significant about that is, yes, there were a lot of those forces were already there, but by bringing up the manning level and bringing up high readiness units, as well as massive amounts of rail and road convoys coming in with huge amounts of ammunition and logistics, setting up hospitals in the event of major casualties, literally making arrangements with local communities to extend cemeteries in case of high casualties. Many of the things that you would never do in terms of a normal exercise, but that you would be prepared to do if you were actually thinking about combat. And while the West reacted with a lot of concern, all of a sudden it kind of got quiet again. And Russian forces all over Russia, were particularly in the Western and Central parts, were practicing and getting ready for Zapad, but at a low level and not pressuring on the Ukrainian front. Sure enough, Zapad happens. What happened with Zapad is they brought in these forces and went into Belarus and the Russian border and worked with the integration of these Russian forces. So remember, I mentioned there were five armies at the height of the Cold War opposite us in the central region of West Germany. First Guards Tank, 2nd, 3rd Shock, 8th Guards, 20th. Well, four of those armies had been brought back against Ukraine. And now, interestingly, the third Army, probably the inheritor of 3rd Shock, was the headquarters and organizing entity for the joint Russian-Belarusian force in this area, which suggests that there may be either a deployment there or very near there with another army. It's sort of interesting. Of 67 armies the Russians could have picked for honorific names, they picked the five that happened to have been against us at the height of the Cold War, and probably with malice aforethought. So you see the red lines, that's now additional troops being brought in and reinforcing the area up by Belarus, which would be the area where that third shock army is, as well as bringing First Guards Tank Army down to the north part of Ukraine and reinforcements from the central military region to the 20th Army in the center, and from the south to the 8th Guards Army at Rostov and Crimea. So it says, well, you know, how might an attack occur and what options does that give them? Well, in 2015, the Russians actually produced, the Western Military District produced an invasion plan for Ukraine. And we have, and it's been authenticated as at least a legitimate draft, whether it was finalized or not, but a version of it did make it to the West and has been recognized as a legitimate draft document. So it gives us a real insight into how they thought about or would think about launching a major campaign. We have about 160 pages of that document. Some of it's extremely detailed, including long lists of targets, bridges for airborne to capture, people to assassinate by Spetsnaz. All the things that go into a very detailed war plan, including a very sophisticated information war campaign specifically targeted on West European members of NATO, specifically Germany and France. So in that war plan, it basically went in three phases. First 10 days would come out of the Donbas in the south and try to link up with Crimea. and also capture the water supply that feeds Crimea and the south. The second 10 days would be a major attack, encirclement of Kharkiv and drive to the Dnieper River, cutting the eastern Ukraine in half with forces driving towards Kiev. And then the last phase was the First Guards Tank Army making a direct run from the Kursk to the outskirts of Kiev. And that's basically where the war plan stopped. So one could do just pieces of that plan, for example, a Crimea Southern campaign, though that would have some the dangers of being Ukraine's being able to counterattack it. One could do the Southern campaign, or one can do the whole thing. What's other areas that have been introduced now is the much heavier likelihood of amphibious assault on Black Sea and Sea of Azov, and also forces coming out of Belarus and hitting Ukraine from the north, and also cutting Ukraine off from NATO in the West. So here would be some examples of the modern day version of, or the current version of that with the forces that are currently or laid out. Now, Ukraine's not gonna be a pushover. So if the Russians are coming in with what was described as a current force level of 60 battalion tactical groups, Ukraine has about 60 battalion tactical groups of its own. Now they're spread around the country and they're forced to cover this 3,000 kilometer, a good portion of them, much more so than in Russia, and certainly more than any other NATO country, are battle hardened and have been in or trained troops of experienced combat. Their equipment is not as good as the Russian, but they've been working hard at it, and they have some small amount of U.S. equipment. For example, you know, the Russians have brought into the area into the Donbass 2,000 armored vehicles. If you add the other armored vehicles around Ukraine, it would be added several thousand more. How did we help Ukraine? We gave them the Javelin anti-tank missile, which offsets the armor advantage. Unfortunately, we've only given them about 120 of the launchers. So we go thousands of armored vehicles and 100 launchers. It's not quite, and it doesn't quite equate. But what's interesting is the Russians were so fearful of that Javelin that they've now been putting tops on top of their tanks, at least the Javelin penetrate. Russia also has a major advantage in the air. And Ukraine Air Force is in dire shape and really needs to be modernized, something that they cannot afford to do on their own resources. Why is all this important? In addition to those who have an emotional, personal commitment to Ukraine, why should the average American give a damn? Well, if you look at it from Russia's perspective, they see that Ukraine is one of the two strategic centers of gravity that hold the security of Eastern Europe. If that center of gravity that's posed in Ukraine or the one in Warsaw in Poland, you essentially cave in the defenses for that region. So some Americans say, well, you know, we really don't feel like fighting for Eastern Europe. And that's been an attitude, by the way, that most Americans have had for 100 years. So World War I, which started in Eastern Europe, we said, oh, we don't want to fight Eastern Europe. But in the end, we got drawn in, lost 170,000 dead. World War II, we stayed out for 2 years, started in Poland. For 2 years, we stayed out. Finally, we got drug in, 400,000 dead. At the end of the Cold War, we led the effort, rightly or wrongly, we led the effort to free the former Warsaw Pact members and modernize them and the republics that were interested in being part of the West. It's unlikely that we'll be able to avoid a future one. If that's the case, who wouldn't want Ukraine to be on our side? If you just look at where their forces are compared to where NATO forces are and the state of their readiness. One other thing sort of interesting, people say, oh, Ukraine's not ready for NATO. Well, they've actually passed more of the NATO requirements than the majority of new members admitted to NATO in terms of the various NATO standardization standards. More importantly, the size of the Ukrainian army is equal to the last 10 members combined to join NATO. So who wouldn't want them to be part of the West? They have some challenges about being able to sustain a long-term competition, which we'll come back to. And there are some advantages for doing it, but I want to stop now and let General Clark provide his insight.
Thank you, Dr. Phil Karber. Can you stop sharing the screen, or shall I do that for you?
Yeah, do it for me. But
you got it. Thank you again. And we will move on to our next speaker. Certainly plenty for everybody to take in from what you said. We have already received a number of questions. This is a good time for me to remind people that the Q&A button is open for you to submit questions. Those will come directly to me, and I will be feeding them to our distinguished speakers today. So if anything comes to you, do not wait till the end. While you're hearing an interesting point that might pop into your head, go ahead and submit a question on the Q&A, and we will then pass those along to our speakers. I'm going to switch now to our next speaker. For those of you who aren't familiar with this face, and many of us have seen him on our television screens for several decades, and you look none worse for the wear, General. Our next speaker is General Wesley Clark. He is the former Supreme Allied Commander and Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. European Command. He commanded Operation Allied Force, NATO's first major combat action, which ended up saving 1.5 million Albanians from ethnic cleansing in Kosovo. In August 2000, General Clark was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor. In 2004, this long-serving and decorated warrior was a major contender during the Democratic presidential primaries and considered to be on the shortlist for the party's vice presidential nominees. In 2014, as I mentioned earlier, General Clark and Dr. Phillip Karber made several trips to Ukraine and authored the first authoritative assessments of what they both came to call the Russo-Ukrainian War that was unfolding at the time. General Clark, it's an honor to have you here with us. I'm sure our listeners would love to hear from you more than me. So the floor is yours.
Oh, Andriy, thanks very much. And Phil, great presentation. Thanks for it's fact-filled. It's incredibly rich in detail. It's authoritative. And there's an awful lot there that all of us will look at again and again and again as we try to figure out what's going to happen. Now, I want to address that because I want to talk about what could happen, what might happen, and what we are sure is happening. My experience with the Russians go back to my first visit, really, in 1964 to Moscow, Leningrad, and Kiev when I was a cadet at West Point. I was fluent in Russian. I met the Red Army lieutenants. We had dinner with them one day in Moscow. I was there as a tourist, a 19-year-old West Point cadet, but it was illuminating to me. During the Cold War, I served in tank units in Germany. I was an assistant to the Supreme Allied Commander of NATO, General Alexander Haig, in the 1978-79 period. I was a tank battalion brigade commander in the 1980s. In the 1990s, I was on the joint staff in Washington, where I led the first U.S.-Russian military staff talks. I remember my trip to Moscow that year. It was July of 1994, and no decision had been made on NATO expansion, but my Russian host said, they asked me, they said, when will your NATO ships be in our port of Riga? And I said, well, you know, there's no decision on that, but the more you ask that question, the more likely they are to be there. I said, as far as I know, that's not your port. Latvia is an independent country. So deep down inside the Russian military establishment and the intelligence establishment has been a refusal to acknowledge the 20th century rules of international order, the rule of law, the right of states to make their own decisions as to their political alignment and so forth. In 1994, when Ukraine had nuclear weapons at the end of the breakup of the Soviet Union, of course, I think we're all familiar with the Budapest assurances, where Russia, the United States, and the United Kingdom assured Ukraine that if it gave up, and when it gave up its nuclear weapons, that its territorial integrity would be protected, as well as its political independence would be protected, and there'd be no threat to either of those. Russia, of course, is obviously violating that lawful pledge that it took in 1994. I remember in 1999, when President Kuchma was inaugurated, shortly thereafter, Poland's national security advisor came to me and he said, "We're in trouble." He said, "I heard the prime minister at that time, Vladimir Putin, in his address at President Kuchma's inauguration say, 'Ukraine and Russia, we are more than brothers. We are in each other's souls.'" And he warned me then, he said, "This man, Putin, wants to reestablish the Soviet Union." Everything we've heard since then is consistent with that warning of 22 years ago. So we know that what we're looking at is a very, very long-term strategic play on the part of Vladimir Putin and his government, the people around him that have supported him, to rebuild the Soviet space in their own way, to undercut the ideas that were signed by President Yeltsin in the assurances to Ukraine in 1994, to make sure that the nations of Eastern Europe do not have political independence, or, and in some cases, don't have territorial integrity. So this is a long-term play. You've seen in Dr. Karber's presentation various elements of it. People today are asking, okay, the United States has given strategic warning. That's what this is, strategic warning. But what's going to really happen? When I talk to learned people in the United States and also in Ukraine, most express doubt that Putin will go through with this. Their view is, you know, there's various reasons. As one man told me, he says, it's hard to explain why, but we just don't think he's going to do it. My initial reaction to that is to recollect that when Phil Karber and I went to Ukraine in the spring of 2014, and we talked to various members of the parliament in Ukraine and other very distinguished people there, they said, why would Putin do this to us? We know his people. We're doing business with Putin's people. Well, they couldn't understand it. And if you look back in history, even in cases of strategic warning, very seldom do people understand it and take it seriously. The United States is a case in point. We had clear strategic warning that the Japanese were going to do something in the fall of 1941. We forced it, didn't take any action. Stalin was warned repeatedly that Hitler would invade, didn't believe it, took no actions in 1941. In 1990-91, Saddam Hussein in Iraq saw us. He knew that we were coming. He saw the buildup of the forces. He had plenty of strategic warning. Didn't believe it. In 2003, the same thing. He didn't believe it. In 1989, the United States took action militarily against Panama's dictator, Manuel Noriega. Noriega provoked it. He saw the U.S. buildup of forces. He knew something was going to happen. And yet, he was caught literally with his pants down when the invasion happened. He just didn't believe it was going to happen. So it's always hard to digest strategic warning and take it seriously. When I talk to my friends in Washington, many of them, former diplomats, very experienced, say it could happen, but probably won't. Representative of this is an article that was published yesterday in Foreign Policy magazine. Some of you may have seen it. And in this article, a very experienced and qualified foreign policy analyst explained he thought conflict was unlikely because it took five conditions for Putin to act. He said there has to be a trigger event, as in the case of Ukraine in 2014 when Yanukovych was overthrown. You have to have local support. And in 2014, Putin believed he had local support from Russians in the Donbass or Russian speakers in the Donbass. You have to anticipate the military reaction. And in Georgia in 2008 and Ukraine in 2014, Putin was pretty sure there wasn't going to be much of a military reaction. It has to be technically feasible. And so you know, it was clearly feasible in 2014 in Donbass. In 2008, it didn't go too well in Georgia, and he called it off. And it has to have a relatively low political and economic cost. So these were the conditions which, as analyst points out, enabled Putin to take military action in 2008, 2014. Now, what you heard from Dr. Karber and what you're going to hear from me is something that raises severe questions about these 5 points. First of all, since 2014, Putin has really developed a nuclear deterrent. He has hypersonics, he has these unguided torpedoes, and he's bragged about it. He's told us all, nuclear deterrent, modernized nuclear deterrent. That's why the United States wants to have talks with Russia about strategic stability. But from Putin's point of view, he may well believe that he has trumped the United States' ability to deter conflict. That is to say, we wouldn't dare risk a confrontation with Russia. He couples this, of course, with cyber, and Russian cyber power is very effective, especially were it to be employed against our electricity grid. Since 2014, the Russian military has been wholesale modernized. These battalion tactical groups that Dr. Karber is talking about, they're new. The officers who lead them have been experienced in Syria or in Donbass. They're full of themselves. They're cocky. They think they've got the best equipment. They think they can do this job. Mr. Putin is, of course, worried about domestic opinion, but that's why he's arresting all of Navalny's associates right now. And he's set in place the means to assure that he remains the lifelong leader of Russia. He has another thing going in his favor. He has energy. This is 30% of Germany's energy. Now, do we really think in the middle of winter that Germany's going to say, okay, we're going to shut down 30% of our heat and we're going to, you know, not buy any gas from you? Really? Germany, Poland, the rest of Europe, we're going to shut all that off? This might be a little hard to convey to President Putin, especially since he's been able to see the outcry as he's sort of choked off the gas. He has energy dominance over Europe right now. He also has an alliance with China. In 1941, Joseph Stalin was very clear in working to build a non-aggression pact with Japan. He brought the Japanese foreign minister to Moscow. He feted him. Local people said this is astonishing that he would deal this way with a mere foreign minister. But he got his non-aggression pact, and he was able to move Soviet troops from the Soviet Far East to begin to align against Germany. Well, what we're seeing today is a very similar pattern, and we're seeing movement of Russian troops from the Far East. It may be that Putin has looked at the United States and said, these are the same people that told me they didn't want to provoke me when I took Crimea. So they said, they told the Ukrainians, just give up the Crimea so you don't make Putin mad. They say they'll react differently this time, but will they? Maybe he's questioning that. Maybe he believes that when the United States said, we want stability in our relationship with you, Russia, maybe he took that the wrong way. We didn't mean it as a sign of weakness, but maybe he misunderstood it. I don't know. And one other thing, you can never actually believe that a potential adversary thinks the same way you do. It's a classic American mistake. Now, for us, we'd say, well, what's the benefit of this? And how many casualties? And what would we say to people? And would we be reelected? We're dealing here in Vladimir Putin with somebody who has seen the effects of American military power firsthand. He was in St. Petersburg when we invaded Iraq. Powerful. We American military, we put behind us the ghost of Vietnam. We had the largest tank battle in history, not covered in the press, 2,000 armored vehicles on a 200-mile front and an enormous left hook. I can tell you that Putin knew what that was. In 1999, after the Russian military had gone to see Slobodan Milosevic said, don't worry about those NATO air threats. We can handle that. He couldn't. Milosevic couldn't. And he saw the enormous power of precision U.S. Air Force strikes. He saw it again in 2001. He saw it in 2003 with the invasion of Iraq, the famous shock and awe. He knows that when military force is used and it's effective and it's competent, the world jumps back. And there may be condemnations, but there's also fear and trepidation, and they're willing to take another look. And this is at the heart of, I believe, what Putin would seek. So what I'm saying is that the Western idea that, well, of course we don't want war, he just wants these demands met. Yes and no. He may actually see the benefits of a short, sharp, massive campaign. Now, we don't know whether he will go or won't go. And we probably will only get a couple of hours of actual tactical notice. So the question is, then, what do we do? I thought the overflight of the E-8 and the rivet joint aircraft over Ukraine to collect intelligence, that was a powerful signal from the administration. I think you'll see more assistance coming from the United States, the administration. I think you'll see our allies lining up to help, the French, the British, in their assisting. What can Ukraine do? I think the most important thing Ukraine can do that it's not doing right now is publicizing what it is doing and what has happened. What I hear from people in Ukraine is there's a big infiltration of Russian Spetsnaz. Oh, have they been captured? And what do we learn from it? Are we going to reveal that to the world, or are we going to keep it secret? I'm told that there are some astonishing things going on with target books being prepared by the Russians. If we know about it, then they must know we know about it, but maybe the world doesn't know about it. Maybe the Ukrainian government can go to the United Nations and ask for help under the 90 for peace resolution. You know, what Putin's doing right now is in violation of international law. You cannot use the threat of force to compel diplomatic negotiations, and he is threatening force. It is illegal. So what I think the strongest weapon we have in our arsenal right now to head this off through deterrence is to invoke publicity and international law. I think the United States government's working very effectively behind the scenes on the sanctions, and I hope they'll work. I think there's continuing consideration of military assistance. I think the overflights of the reconnaissance aircraft is a very strong sign. And one last thing I'd tell you, in February of 1950, U.S. Secretary of State Dean Acheson outlined to the world the U.S. defense perimeter in Asia. It included, of course, Formosa over Taiwan and Japan, but it didn't include South Korea. So taking advantage of that, North Korean dictator Kim Il-sung went to Stalin and said he'd like to invade. Stalin said, well, you have to clear that with Mao. And so he went to Mao. And Mao thought about it, said, you know, there's a big risk. He says, because I don't trust the United States, even though they still might come in. But ultimately, he agreed to it for his own motives. Sure enough, even though the United States had said that was not our defense perimeter, after the North Koreans crossed the 38th parallel and invaded South Korea, the United States did choose to defend South Korea. And we did send U.S. forces there. In 1999, when we began the air campaign in Kosovo, President Bill Clinton said he had no intention of putting ground troops in. That was a smart move politically. If he'd said he was going to send ground troops to Yugoslavia, people in the United States would have said, well, where is that place? And why would our American boys go over there and fight? And yet, despite the fact that he said that, in 6 weeks, he then said that NATO would do anything necessary to succeed. And I was given the authority to plan for ground invasion of Kosovo. And we were planning it. So the fact that of where we are right now doesn't necessarily mean that's where we'll end up. So I think that, Andriy, I think this group here has enormous influence on the United States, and I hope some in Ukraine. And I would remind everybody that we're in the information warfare stage now. Ukraine is a sovereign state. It's being assailed by a potential aggressor, and that is a violation of international law. So what does Putin want out of it? I think Putin wants out of it something larger than Ukraine. If he only wanted the Minsk agreements, it wouldn't be like this. What he wants is something larger. He wants to shatter NATO. And for that, nothing would work better than a sharp shock and awe campaign if it were successful. So I want to close by just underscoring the seriousness of the strategic warning that Dr. Karber has presented. This could be bargaining leverage. It could also be much more than that. We are warned. We must be ready and we must deter. Thank you, Andriy.
Thank you, General Clark. I think I am some kind of biblical parable about being unready for what I've asked for, because we have received a number of questions. They have come through emails, the question and answer here. And I think for the benefit of everybody involved, we might get into a session of grouping several of these questions to start. So I'm going to bring on Dr. Karber and yourself, and I'll present to you, since you just talked about what happened in the 90s with the air war and mentioned something about enforcing, there we did have a question right off the top from our good friend Yuri Dejakiewski, who specifically asked about the feasibility of NATO or the United States enforcing a no-fly zone over Ukrainian airspace. Have there been such precedents? And I'll add to that the fact that we also got an email about the fact that it seems to be that Russia's encroachment on other territories seem to fall further south than the 53rd parallel. I believe Minsk is around the 53rd, 54th parallel. So is it a no-fly zone, or is it, if Russia does something serious, do we go back to the example you cited earlier about North Korea?
Well, let me answer first, and then I'll turn to Dr. Karber. There's been no talk that I know of a no-fly zone, because a no-fly zone is a peace enforcement measure. And what we don't have here is not an internal conflict. It is aggression by a foreign power. So the United States has said thus far that it will not intervene militarily. So this would seem to rule out something like a no-fly zone, or let's say an air defense cap by U.S. aircraft. However, I think it'd be a smart move for the United States to deploy air expeditionary forces to, let's say, Poland and Romania, who are, in the event of a Russian action, would become frontline states in this. And those air assets would be an important element of NATO deterrent to any further Russian action.
Thank you. Dr. Karber.
I agree completely on that. Just being a bit creative, you know, we're currently flying intelligence aircraft over Ukraine. So there's no reason why, if General Clark's recommendations, we had modern F-15 fighters in Poland and Romania, that we couldn't be escorting those reconnaissance aircraft just to ensure their safety. The net effect of that is in essence, an implied no-fly zone, but just being creative.
Yeah. We had a number of questions that were specific, and maybe this relates to some of the fears that people are having. This is part of the gestation of some of these, the fact that we got this group together is because people are really afeared, and rightly so, given Dr. Karber's presentation. So there are some simple matter of fact questions I believe that both of you can answer to our audience, one of which relates to this concept of a guerrilla war that they read about in the paper. Is that something that Ukraine is equipped for and would be able to carry out? We've heard that that's something that possibly the United States could help guide Ukraine post a swift offensive. There's also a very simple question about why does one wage a war during the winter? Maybe people have seen some World War II movies, World War I movies of people getting bogged down in the winter. Why would you drive tanks over in the winter? Isn't that something that's counterintuitive? And you can answer that question. And then lastly, I'd like to add, I don't know if you've related, if any of you can comment on this question that was brought up earlier, is that can Russia maintain this war economically? Is that something that they have the resources to do going forward?
So, Phil, may I offer a couple of thoughts and then turn to you?
Please.
So, first of all, with respect to the insurgent warfare of civil resistance and putting these civil defense groups together, which I understand is being done right now and very effective, I commend the government of Ukraine for doing this. I understand that women as well as men are joining up on this, and I hope that it will be effective. On the other hand, we know that against a determined main force that's equipped with artillery, main battle tanks, and chemical weapons, this kind of civilian defense is not a real long-term defense, provided the attacking force is willing to be utterly ruthless. In Russian military doctrine, as in Soviet military doctrine, the use of chemical weapons is delegated to the commanders. It is not a political decision. The political decision is to start the attack, and then they get to pick whichever weapon they want. So we know that Russians have non-persistent nerve agent. If they used it, you might never know it was even used. So it is a strong initial means of resistance. And I think every Ukrainian American understands that there was resistance against the Soviet reoccupation after World War II that lasted for 5 or 6 years, just as there was in many other of these East European countries. But it was crushed out, and it was crushed out ruthlessly. So I think it's the best that can be done. If that's the best that can be done, I salute the courage of the people and determination of the people in Ukraine. But I don't think it's necessarily a long-term winning strategy. I think the real strategy is understand what Putin wants and deter it and make him understand no matter how good he thinks his military is, he will pay an unacceptable price internationally for this. Could he survive economically? Well, the price of oil is going to go way up if he attacks. So if he could sell it, that'd be a good thing. If he can't get it out, he won't make much money off of it. But the Russians have many, many assets hidden in the West, much support in the West. So this will be a real second struggle, theater struggle in there. Phil, thank you. Please go ahead.
So on the resistance, I don't want to speak to it as an American. I'm absolutely personally offended that people in the administration who don't have the guts or the willpower to stand up to Russia and to supply Ukraine with the military equipment that they need to prevent a war, then hide behind the idea of, oh, we'll sneak him a few Barrett sniper rifles and pat him on the back in a guerrilla war. I find that absolutely insulting to the Ukrainians and humiliating as an American. In terms of the economy, I think if the Russians can get whatever strategic objective they want in Ukraine with combat. So somebody asked me the other day, well, doesn't Putin have to use this force because he's gotten a lot of expense bringing it there? And gee, if he keeps it there several months, isn't he going to need to, you know, to justify that to use it? I go, no. If he can get what he wants without ever actually having to cross the border, it's the best deal he'll ever get. So, but if he can keep a campaign relatively fast and limited objectives, I mean, you know, maybe up to the Dnieper, which is not hardly limited, but still it's not all of Ukraine. Once he has occupied the area and secured it, at least initially, those around him in the West and other countries are going to be very anxious to try to return to normal. So the other side, ironically, will have a lot of bargaining power in terms of backing out and trading pieces of terrain for this or that or refugees or so forth. So, but if it drags on, in another 8 years, absolutely, his economy will really suffer from it.
Winter warfare, we didn't answer that one. Look, if you have armored vehicles and you'd like to make a fast move, it's better to do it in the winter than any other time, because that way the ground is frozen, some of the small streams are frozen, it's uncomfortable for defenders. They can't, you're inside an armored vehicle, you're moving, you have the initiative, you can avoid minefields, you can avoid blown bridges. And so it's in many respects, it's favorable. Now, if there's very bad visibility and you can't see and aircraft can't support you, then it's not favorable. So as the ground is beginning to freeze in eastern Ukraine, and I'm watching the weather forecast every day, and I notice in the Kharkiv area, it's just above 0 Fahrenheit at night now, and it's in the teens during the day. They tell me the ground is frozen to about 6 to 8 inches. Maybe they'd like it to freeze a little bit more, but that window of opportunity is opening up for off-road armored maneuver.
And then, of course, when the thaw happens, then you have a number of weeks, maybe even a month of mud, which really makes it difficult. One of the other advantages of winter is it's extremely hard for defenders to dig in. And so once they've broken through the Donbas or attacked other areas, if the defenders try and dig into frozen ground, it's very slow. And it's very obvious to UAVs and where the defenders are. So it actually has an asymmetry that favors the attacker.
Thank you so much. The next relates a lot to, next several group of questions relate a lot to the presentation and the maps that people saw. We've gotten a number of questions asking about Russian troops around Ukraine's border. So we know, we see on the map and we see on the news, apart from Dr. Carver's maps, the maps people put out about what's happening in Donbas, the fact that Crimea is an area that attacks can be launched from. But people, two people have asked questions about where does Transnistria stand in this? And does that mean that Bessarabia or the broader Odessa area should be considered in danger, whether from the land or from the sea? Also, people are wondering, when they see our maps, about the number of divisions of Russian soldiers, that there seem to be a concentration in Kaliningrad. And does that mean that post anything happening in Ukraine, because Ukraine, we all know, happened after Georgia, and that happened after nothing happened regarding a cyber attack on Estonia. And we know that troops have been stationed in Transnistria and not letting Moldova have that sovereign territory. So in terms of possibly a step further, there was a question whether that deployment of troops then cuts off the Baltics. And does that mean, and this is probably all of your expertise, does that mean that those Eastern European countries, whether it's Poland or the Baltic countries and other ones, need to start thinking about defense in a way that NATO is not comfortable with them doing so? So the first question is about those land areas. So Transnistria, Bessarabia, also what happens to Mariupol? Is that, certainly on the highway of destruction?
Wes, you want me to pick that, start with that?
Yeah, please.
So the Russians had an army group in Transnistria, which is then became a peacekeeping force. It's normally about two battalions, though there's a pre assigned equipment there that could be probably brought up. After the invasion of Crimea in 2014, several of the Spetsnaz units were actually transferred and beefed up in Transnistria. But it's relatively, but it's only just a couple of battalions in peacetime normally. There are several volunteer militia brigades of local Russians who are also equipped, and they have APCs and a few tanks and Russian fire support. But they're not what I would call a major offensive threat. However, during 2014, there were groups that came out of Transnistria and blew up bridges in the around Odessa and generally caused problems. And so it would be prudent military would put opposite that area a certain number of Ukrainian battalions, which of course keeps them from being deployed elsewhere. In terms of Kaliningrad, if you look back to 2013 or so, the buildup there has virtually doubled. There were just independent units there, some Marines and some Army units, which the Army units were not in a high state of readiness. They've been equipped with modern equipment. Russians brought in the Iskander surface-to-surface missile, long-range missile. Sometimes they bring it in, bring it out, but it's believed to have nuclear weapons there. At least the European Commission found that to be probable. Not only that, they created a core headquarters and just recently added additional divisional size unit formation there. So there's a significant increase in Kaliningrad. You still have the corridor between Poland and the Baltic, but it's getting very, very narrow. And so effort coming out of Belarus and out of Kaliningrad shuts that. That's why, you know, others in Europe or in Washington can sort of ignore what's happening in Ukraine, but the guys who don't ignore it, it's interesting. The Estonians are the first ones who said they're going to send what little they have, they're going to send military assistance now to Ukraine. The Latvians, the Lithuanians, the Poles are all very, very threatened by developments in Ukraine. Not the least of which we didn't mention, is if there is a significant invasion, even just up to the Dnieper, you're facing or the prospect of 10 million Ukrainian refugees fleeing west. 10 million. The Poles think they have a problem now with Russian forces in Belarus. You add another tank army sitting in Western Ukraine and NATO is in dire trouble. So they really are concerned.
So Phil, I just want to add two things to what you said. There are two principles that come out of Russian military history and activities. One is effective use of reserve forces. And the Russians, more than Western armies, have really concentrated based on their experience on the what we call the Eastern Front during World War II. They learned how to husband and use reserves so that the first push was not necessarily the major threat. The major threat is the second echelon. Dr. Karber wrote all about this and educated us back in the 1980s when I was a lieutenant colonel in the United States Army. I remember reading these studies of World War II and the operational maneuver group theories and the other things. We knew that the real thrust is, and the way you have to defeat this, is to defeat the Russian reserve elements. So it's not about where the first attack is. It's about where the real objective, the thrust is. So for example, in an attack, looking at the map, as Dr. Karber right, maybe you would put forces around Kharkiv and drive toward Kyiv. This would paralyze, perhaps the Russians would think, the reserve forces that are held in Ukraine because they've got to defend Kyiv and the Dnieper crossings. In the meantime, once those reserve forces are in locations, they're targeted by long-range fires, and the main Russian thrust comes along the axis, Mariupol toward Odessa, linked with amphibious groups to cut off Ukraine. So we don't know. But here's the second principle. The Russians have been really good in their military activities at using deception, what's called maskirovka. And so we're not going to be able to divine what their likely intent is. What we have to do is understand that they are experts at deception, and they operate with something called reflexive control. That is to say, they're directing their deception to make us believe what they want us to believe, so we will take actions that are the actions they want. We have to be able to see through that. So there's got to be a lot of give and take, push and shove on the deception phase. What it means is, when we commit our reserves, we need to deceive on where our reserves are going to. So this deception on both sides never goes away. So there's a tremendous emphasis going to be placed on electronic warfare, on communications intelligence, on satellite intelligence, on human intelligence from the ground, and so forth. So it's going to be an intelligence war as well as a tank war, at least to get started.
Wes, I wanted to add to that. I should have mentioned it earlier. An interesting difference about what's going on now versus in the spring. In the spring, the Russians were pretty open about their deployments and which units. In fact, even would write in the military journal the name of the unit being sent to purpose. Now they're actually using fake unit numbers. They're moving stuff at night. They're putting stuff in the forest and working with camouflage and trying to hide it and deceive, having units get off in certain places and then so they're not seen by moving by train and so forth. So there now is a fairly conscious effort to cover up a lot of stuff.
Thank you. Before we move on to our additional speaker, and that will be great to answer a lot of these questions that are coming in. We have a broad range. We've kind of focused them on what you spoke about, both of you spoke about earlier, so that we don't get into the United Nations and red lines and things like that. But before we turn to Michael, I'd like to ask both of you one topic that has returned to a number of times in the questions, and that is about NATO membership. One of them is, frankly, there are political questions: who's blocking it? Why isn't it happening? But the other one, the other ones are also: isn't it time at this point to at least start that discussion with Ukraine? And how do you assess Ukraine? What is your assessment of the timeline for that to happen, apart from politically, in terms of the reforms needed? There's a specific question about what other reforms should be done by Ukraine and emphasized by Ukraine to get to that point. And I'll close by asking that, you know, I don't believe any other NATO country has enemy forces on their territory that sent a couple of sorties to Afghanistan to help out their friends evacuate people. So if a country like Ukraine can do that, what's preventing it from joining that club?
Yeah. Okay, well, Phil, you want me to take a first stab at this?
Yeah, please.
So one of the criteria we established 25 years ago for NATO membership was that territorial claims and borders would be settled and solid. So, you know, right up front, it's clear that you still got an active conflict in eastern Ukraine. So that is prima facie reason for certain NATO members to say, no, Ukraine's not ready to join NATO. But I think the deeper truth is this, that the United States is not going to give up on the right of nations in eastern Europe, including Ukraine, to choose their own political future and to choose their defense associations as they see fit, which means the door will be held open to Ukraine membership. Now, at the present moment, the situation is cloudy. We've got talks coming up in January. We know that. We don't know whether those talks are serious or simply designed to provoke a casus belli to enable Putin to justify an attack later. We know that the United States has been accused of bringing chemical weapons into Ukraine. That's the kind of pretext that sounds like Putin's heard before. That was what we were saying before we went into Iraq the last time. So it sounds like he's setting up a trigger event possibly. So we don't know. And in the context of that uncertainty, and before these talks happen, it's not going to be possible to really define Ukraine's future membership timelines for NATO. It's just not possible. When we started the NATO enlargement process in the 1990s, and I was there a part of that, we actually hoped that Russia would someday become a member of NATO, because we hoped that there could be a Europe that was free and whole from the Atlantic to the Urals, as the French liked to say. But it didn't happen. And we were unable, for the reasons I explained in my opening remarks, ever to convince the Russian military that NATO could be their friends. They needed an enemy. They have an enemy. And they're about to make it much worse. And they're about to make a very serious mistake if they move forward. But I think in terms of Ukraine's NATO membership, we have to leave it as it is right now. Let's see what happens in January.
So in my view, the number one focus should be the United States needs to realize that Ukraine is in a successful defense. The only way you're going to deter Russia is not by talk and not by threatening to take the bully's lunch money away from him, but meet him where he is pushing us. So he says, no NATO in Ukraine and no Ukraine in NATO. I think we should push back and say, wait a minute, Ukraine offers more than the last 10 members to join NATO. They have already passed most of the more proportionally of NATO requirements. Leaving aside some allied sensitivities or predispositions, from a military alliance perspective, Ukraine is overdue to be in the alliance, in my opinion. I agree with the general that when we were doing the enlargement, there were countries that had these minor border disputes and so forth. Nobody wanted to end up with a situation where, like we had back in the 60s and 70s with Greece and Turkey, where you had two NATO members actually shooting at each other. So it was like, well, if you're going to join, you got to solve these local issues. That's different than a country being invaded by an enemy of the rest of the alliance. And my point is particularly the Germans, because they're the ones who use that argument most. Oh, well, we can't have Ukrainian because they have a conflict problem with their border. What the hell was the Iron Curtain going through East and West Germany with five Russian armies in East Germany if that wasn't a divided border? So if we thought at the time, only 10 years after Germany had committed huge crimes and started a massive war, that within 10 years, we nonetheless thought that they would benefit by being part of the West, that they would contribute to the alliance and learn to be democratic. And by the way, that was a pretty good bet and it worked out. Why should the rules be any different for Ukraine? I'd like to also just return to the earlier point in closing, when I was asked about the Baltics and Poland. And there's a question about what can Americans do who are frustrated that it doesn't seem like we are backing Ukraine like we should in our own strategic interest, that we are unable to see or articulate. And I would offer three points. One, stop begging and saying, oh, just a few green, a couple of javelin for Bruce. Rather make the argument it is in our strategic interest to have Ukraine solid and that center of gravity. And every Ukrainian on that front is one less American kid who's got to be in Eastern Europe defending. And we need to make that point. It's not that we're doing them favors. They're doing us a huge favor by holding back that dike. Secondly, in terms of the alliance, from my experience, maybe the general sees it differently, but from my experience, the alliance does not like to be led from behind. They don't like us to be bossy. But when something is really truly strategically important, you don't do it by having a group grow. You quietly, under the table, say, guys, it's time to get serious. and this is important, and this is strategic, and it's necessary. That means that we're leading. Follow us, and don't block it up for silly stuff. Lastly, I think it's very important for those who are concerned about Ukraine and possibility of war to become much more politically active. And now is the time to unify those who have a joint interest. It's not just the Ukrainians and the Ukrainian diaspora. There's the Poles, there's the Baltics, it's time to recreate the old captive nations, only now it's the free nations who don't want to be captive. You know, that was a very powerful movement during the period of the Iron Curtain. Well, the Iron Curtain's down, but now we had to reform that group, that coalition as a coalition, and not just be caught up with the individual national interests and start making it known. And that is a very powerful block. If you look at where they're concentrated in Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, you can have substantial influence disproportionately to the number of East Europeans. And I really believe it's time to create that unified block and become very, very articulate in promoting it. Thank you, Andriy, and thank you, John.
Michael, you're listening. You couldn't ask for a better lead-in. So before I turn the camera over to Michael, gentlemen, I'm going to let Michael share his screen. He's just going to run over some of the legislative initiatives. If you want to take a drink of water, it'll be all covered. If you want to keep on with us for just a closing after Michael, we would appreciate that as well. But Michael will have the floor now. So without further ado, I'm going to welcome to the screen our vice president and the director of the UNIS office in Washington, D.C., Michael Sawkiw, Jr. Michael was the previous president of UCCA. He is also the chairman of the U.S. Committee on Holodomor Awareness. If you aren't signed up for the UNIS Action Alerts, we will make sure after this meeting that you are on Michael's list, because there are numerous action alerts of things that are happening in Washington, D.C. that everybody should be aware of. And Michael, if you could please run us through what's happening right now.
Well, Andriy, thank you. Thank you very much for this opportunity. To General Clark and to Dr. Karber, thank you for your excellent presentations. It was truly not just informative, but obviously stokes to exactly what is necessary in terms of administering a U.S. strategic policy towards Ukraine. There exists a U.S.-Ukraine strategic partnership. Let's make that partnership whole and of benefit to both countries. As Andriy had mentioned, I do have a quick presentation about a few of the congressional initiatives which exist Ukraine related. These were initiatives which partook in 2021. Congress has already finished its first session. That concluded at the end of December before they went home for their Christmas and New Year's holiday season. And will begin again for their second session at the beginning of January. One of the most important pieces of legislation that happened in the late days of the first session of Congress was S-3407, which is called the GUARD Act. The GUARD Act is Guaranteeing Ukrainian Autonomy by Reinforcing Its Defense Act. This is analogous to several amendments which were proposed to the National Defense Authorization Act of 2022. Unfortunately, those various amendments did not pass muster, did not get included into the final bill, which was just signed by President Biden recently in the past few days. This takes the next step. This takes the step to a next level as a standalone piece of legislation. And it highlights exactly what were in those amendments to the NDAA. It calls out Russia as a state sponsor of terror. It provides foreign military financing to Ukraine. It helps to certify and implement the sanctions for Nord Stream 2. I think that is most relevant and most important, that what we're dealing with here are not just what was described by General Clark and Dr. Karber in terms of the military component here, but there's also an economic component. There's also the info war, which is going on, and the hybrid aggression, which is happening in Ukraine, that must be obviously confronted when it comes to all aspects of Russian aggression. This bill would provide $50 million for military assistance to Ukraine in the next fiscal year, but also it helps to stabilize Ukraine as a country in terms of its economy. It would provide cybersecurity. It would provide sectoral reforms in Ukraine for macroeconomic stabilization, for other aspects of investment, foreign investment, direct investment opportunities for American businesses and so forth. This is a great opportunity to contact your senators. There are 9 senators already that have sponsored this particular bill. Yes, it is of one particular party. That doesn't mean, however, that others in the second session starting in early January will support this particular bill. Ukraine Religious Freedom Support Act. Again, this is not just an opportunity to talk about the physical, the tactical aggression, which is going on right now vis-a-vis Ukraine, but also in terms of what is happening in those occupied lands that Russia controls right now, whether it's Crimea or in eastern Ukraine. The Ukraine Freedom Religious Freedom Support Act goes exactly to that, to the specifics of the international humanitarian law that holds Russia responsible and accountable for the violations of religious freedom in those occupied territories. This is, once again, another opportunity to show Russian aggression in all its various forms. This is a very interesting piece of legislation, which was proposed by Senator Shaheen from New Hampshire, a great friend of Ukraine, one of the co-chairs of the congressional vice chairs of the Senate Ukraine caucus, as well as the co-chair of the Congressional Ukrainian caucus, Representative Marcy Kaptur. It is a Transatlantic Telecommunications Security Act. And this deals with enhancing telecommunications for countries in Central and East Europe that may be under malign influence from foreign actors. Those foreign actors being specifically mentioned in this legislation being the Russian Federation and the People's Republic of China. So this particular bill and this initiative is analogous in the Senate as it is in the House of Representatives, provides funding for those countries to enhance their 5G telecommunications integration with other countries in the West so that they don't fall under any type of future malign influence. Congressional resolutions, they are very important because they provide at least a signal as to the support that is happening for Ukraine. Most recently was one that was proposed by Senator Durbin, S-480, is to support a democratic Ukraine in light of the Russian aggression that is going on. And also S-360, a little late in terms of celebrating Ukraine's 30th anniversary, that has been proposed by Senators Portman and Senator Shaheen. One other very specific and of noteworthy opportunity of initiatives in Congress when it comes to Ukraine is called the Three C's Initiative. Three C's Initiative is another initiative, much like the previous legislation in terms of the Telecommunications Security Act. It provides an opportunity to meld and to integrate a lot of the economies of Central and East Europe that are right now dealing with various aspects of market reform, that are dealing with moving further and investing in their future capacities. Future capacities could be transportation networks. Future capacities could obviously be telecommunications networking and integration. And obviously getting energy security, which is very dire and very severe when it comes to those countries in Central and East Europe. The United States has provided already $1 billion that is authorized for countries from the Baltics to the Black Sea And this is an opportunity for Ukraine as well to participate in that. The Ukraine Security Partnership Act, this was introduced earlier this year. This is very analogous to the first piece of legislation, the GUARD Act. It takes many of the same requirements and statements of policy from the Ukraine Security Partnership Act of 2021 and puts it into the GUARD Act. So we hope that a lot of these bills, as we see right now, that many of them can meld together for the benefit of having a cohesive U.S. policy for Ukraine. What are we to see, and what do we anticipate coming in 2022? A lot was mentioned actually in the first session of Congress about kleptocracy. Kleptocracy is also another opportunity to not just a slap on the wrist for Putin and his particular oligarchs, but this is also an opportunity to define the Russian government for exactly what it is, that it is an opportunity to show the aggression which happens on an economic basis, that happens on a political basis, obviously that happens in an energy manner, that happens in kinetic warfare. And all of this obviously goes to providing an opportunity to further sanction individuals in Russia. Russia sanctions, I believe, in 2022 will be a win-win for many types of major legislation, both in the House of Representatives and in the Senate. As was mentioned by the president of the UCCA, Andriy Futey, he had mentioned in terms of various sectoral sanctions. I believe that that is what will be precipitated in 2022. We had a flavor for that in terms of the various amendments that were provided in the National Defense Authorization Act of FY 2022, which unfortunately did not make it into the final bill. However, I believe that we're looking at a very large scale, a second large scale Russia sanctions bill coming in the very near future. Nord Stream 2 obviously was discussed in the energy security that it provides, obviously for Ukraine in terms of what might happen should Nord Stream 2 and the political pipeline go through. And obviously, what does that necessarily mean in terms of Russia's malign influence on our allies in the rest of Europe as well? It was most interesting that we also discussed NATO. The NATO summit will be coming up again this summer. Ukraine is to participate in that particular summit. I think at least a discussion in Congress and within the administration about where Ukraine should be and to provide at least some type of guidance where Ukraine should be in terms of a membership action plan and eventually membership for that country. As Dr. Karber had mentioned, Ukraine already has a lot more troops than the 10 most recent acceptees into the NATO alliance. And we had failed to mention about Crimea. I think it's very important that year in and year out, there are resolutions in Congress, as well as statements of policy by the administration about Crimea and the non-recognition of the Crimean illegal annexation by the Russian Federation. Most interesting is what Dr. Karber had mentioned in his final remark about being active. This is what our work at the Ukrainian National Information Service, the Washington office of the UCCA, is all about. It is about providing a forum for you to express your concerns. Voice your concerns, email members of Congress. There are action alerts which emanate from the UNIS office in Washington, D.C. almost on a weekly basis. This is necessary in terms of having our voice heard. And also, I'd like to accentuate something that Dr. Karber said. We as a Ukrainian diaspora are not in this just by ourselves. Whether it's 2 million that we have in the United States or however many 20 plus million that we have throughout the world, we are also in partnership with our longstanding friends, whether it is the Polish community, the Baltic community, the Georgian community, and others in other Central and East European communities that do understand the viability of having a very strong policy for United States in Central and East Europe, but specifically right now as it pertains to Ukraine. And obviously what we're coming upon in 2022 will be midterm elections for all 435 seats in the House of Representatives, as well as for 34 Senate seats. I highly advise you to please participate in the political process. Please vote, please register, please vote, vote in primaries if you can, attend to whatever capacity that we can during this pandemic, attend any open town halls, ask questions of relevant questions to candidates, make them questions about foreign policy. Foreign policy, obviously, the United States is the leader of the free world. Members of Congress and those candidates need to hear from us in terms of taking action, in terms of voicing our concerns for a strong U.S. Strategic partnership with Ukraine and a strong policy for Central and East Europe. So I thank you very much. I don't want to take up too much additional time here in case the general or Dr. Karber have any other additional closing comments. But please feel free to contact us. Please, we will put you on our email distribution lists. Follow us on social media, whether it is on Facebook, whether it is on Instagram or on Twitter, and obviously participate in the process as much as possible. Thank you.
And thank you, Michael. We're going to add the rest of us back here. Before Dr. Karber comes back in, you mentioned so many things, and as a little bit of housekeeping, I know so many people have asked questions about Dr. Karber's presentation, what they've seen today. At the top of this program, I mentioned that this program is being streamed both on Facebook and YouTube, so you can go back and review everything if you were trying to take notes and trying to draw the map yourself, or maybe you didn't get exactly the resolution that Michael mentioned, but also any documents that we have presented here in the follow-up email you get generated by Zoom, which is thank you for attending this webinar. I will do my best to include as many links as possible to all these publications that you see here. And that includes what Michael just put down. So if you missed one of those resolutions, it's very important. I do have two questions to Michael. One is, I see by the people who are attending today that we have some people who may have written to their congressman before in pen and ink, and then some people who are more accustomed to doing everything online. However, when I go to my congressman's website, I can't find a single email. How do I contact a congressperson or a senator today, Michael?
Very interesting question. There are two ways about it, and specifically when it comes to the pandemic in particular. During the pandemic, Congress obviously was working virtually, staffers as well as the members themselves. The best way is there is a form on every single member of Congress, whether it's a House of Representatives or a member of the Senate. Every single member has a specific page dedicated to them. And on their specific pages, there is an opportunity to contact them, to provide them with your concerns, to provide them with any thoughts that you might have about various policies. So at least during the pandemic, that would be the most beneficial and the most efficient way of going about it. Obviously, from my years in Washington, D.C., and interacting with many members of Congress, they always do like to receive a physical in-person, a physical letter that was handwritten by someone. So if there is still an opportunity to do that, the mail is a bit slow right now. Hopefully post-holidays, things will pick up a little bit. But if there is an opportunity to do a handwritten letter to your member of Congress or to your senator, that would be most beneficial as well.
And you did mention that this will be an election year. So some of this legislation that you brought up may not get finished in time, but I do recall that lots of pieces of legislation that exist today started as individual bills. So we know that PSCA ended up in a funding bill. It wasn't a standalone bill. There were other things that our community supported, but given the how much support a bill generates, does that bode well for that bill being included later on in Congress, even though you might put all your eggs in one basket, but that doesn't mean that bill is dead necessarily?
Never. Things are never necessarily dead. Things always reformat themselves in Congress. It's what they call the sausage making of legislation. So whether it is a standalone bill, which hopefully obviously sends a stronger signal about the policies in said bill, in said legislation and initiative. However, if there are other opportunities to morph them into larger bills obviously have a tendency to pass on a more bipartisan basis. I'd like to stress, however, if I didn't stress this enough in my presentation, on how much of a bipartisan effort exists and support exists in Congress for Ukraine-related concerns. This is not just since 2014, since the Revolution of Dignity. This has always existed. And luckily enough, we as a Ukrainian community, whether Republican, Democrat, or independent, interact very well with their respective elected officials. And therefore, it makes it well known to those elected officials that this is an opportunity to support Ukraine. So please continue all your efforts that you have been doing. Not just you, send these emails, send all these alerts to your friends, to your family, to your relatives, get everybody on board. 2022 will be a very decisive year, not just for the elections, but obviously for any type of foreign policy, and especially what we have been discussing for the past hour about the situation in Ukraine.
Absolutely. We're going to bring back the person who instigated us getting involved politically, and that's Dr. Phil Karber. We also have General Clark with us. I'm also going to add the head of one of the co-sponsoring organizations here today, Mykola Hrytskovyan, as we get into the finale of our wonderful discussion today. And I can't thank enough everybody who stayed around and all the wonderful questions. Again, we will be sending out what you saw today in the follow-up email. So if you haven't seen it, we will send a link of the YouTube that you can share to your friend or also to review yourself. I will include in that a list of events that UCCA has marked on the calendar this year. And that does include a list of every state primary, which begin as of March 1st in the first state. But that means that between now and then, there's plenty of people who have already gotten themselves listed as a candidate or have declared that they'll be a candidate. So you can go out to them when you hear that President Biden is having a summit with Putin, and you can ask them, what do you think about that? Let's see how much attention can be brought to Ukraine, because as our two distinguished gentlemen have said, a lot more attention should be paid to this. And as I know from the many questions that we've heard from our audience today, it seems that not enough attention has been paid, and that's why there are so many questions here. With that in mind, Mykola, I'm going to ask you, as a representative of many of these organizations who came together to co-sponsor this, ask of our two main speakers some final questions. Wait, you got to unmute. Hold on. There you go. All right,
there we go. Final questions here. It's good to see you, Dr. Karber and General Clark. It's been really great to be working with you these past few years since 2014. I just want to follow up on something that General Clark had to say. He brought up the fact that the most important thing at this point is deterrence. And we know that it's been reported that the White House has prepared a $200 million package of military aid, but they have delayed that in hopes of some sort of diplomatic solution. And then on top of that, and this is to reinforce what Dr. Karber said, apparently the head of the National Security Council, Sullivan, had said, well, we have $400 million ready to go if the Russians attack. And, you know, it kind of doesn't make sense to me. Why are they not giving this aid right now to Ukraine and to act as a deterrent? Because even if they give $200 million worth of aid after the Russians attack, that's kind of like closing the barn door after it burns down. And, you know, we've talked amongst ourselves and we're saying we should probably do a all out advocacy campaign directed at the White House with letters, with emails, and all, because it's President Biden who's the one who can give the orders to release this aid. And we have a very small window. He's meeting with Putin on the 10th. They're saying this invasion might happen at the end of January. That's when the ground is frozen. And you know, I'm just my question is to the both of you is what do we need to do to move the White House? We as a diaspora, as voters, as a united diaspora with other diasporas, Poles and Balts. What do we need to do to move the White House to release that aid?
Dr. Karber or General Clark, do you have any ideas of how to motivate the White House on this in this respect, in terms of releasing vital aid that's needed? I know that, Michael, I believe that's one of the things that President Zelensky asked if anybody is advocating. Can we speed up the aid coming from other countries?
My short answer is elect General Clark as president.
Phil, I was going to say, I think there's two things that that will strengthen Ukraine. Number one is, of course, winning the information battle right mm-hmm. now. So explaining what's happening, being open with the public about the real threat, going to the United Nations and calling for a UN Security Council meeting. Doesn't matter that the Russians and Chinese are going to say no. You get the headlines from trying. Americans love an underdog, and this is an underdog situation. And this is our underdog, just like Dr. Karber said. And you know, Americans have to become acquainted with the situation. So this requires a lot of work with the press, a lot of work in New York with the United Nations Security Council. It requires some headlines. It requires. I mean, it works either way. If the Russians say no, the headline is Russians refuse UN meeting to discuss their threat to Ukraine. If the Russians say yes, you lay out all the threat. And then it says, you know, Russia threatening Ukraine, you show photographs and everything like this. So, you know, this is the basic stuff of winning the information battle. And the United States, of course, is a democracy. And so when it captures public attention, people listen in Congress and in the White House. Now, the strategy of the administration is a very logical strategy. It says that really China is the real long-term challenge to the United States. And if we could just stabilize the relationship with Putin, if he just wouldn't be such a damn troublemaker, then, you know, everything would be okay. And we can focus on setting up new supply chains, blocking Chinese investment, winning the technology battle against China and so forth. And that's the direction they've been headed. This move by Putin's quite an annoyance. I mean, it threatens to throw a monkey wrench in. Plus, there's the challenge that people think, well, maybe this is the time China would go to take Taiwan. So I think those kinds of considerations have to be laid out to the public. And I think if they are, the administration will be strengthened in its ability to respond with greater effectiveness in the deterrent phase. Right now, it's an information struggle. And what you've seen is from the Russian side, Putin bragging about invincible atomic hypersonic missiles, and the Minister of Defense saying, NATO putting, you know, provoking us and putting chemical weapons in to our allies in Europe. These are serious charges and must be taken seriously. Our allies in Europe are not like the Americans. The Americans say international law, what's that? Who cares about international law? Jesse Helms never liked the United Nations, can't stand them, bunch of whatever, whatever. Don't fund them, peacekeeping, no good, blah, 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 blah. But to our allies, the United Nations pronouncements are international law. And the way we really defeated Slobodan Milosevic in 1999, well, the air campaign worked, the invasion threat helped, but when he got indicted by the International Criminal Tribunal on Yugoslavia, and he was sanctioned under international law, no Europeans could talk to him at that point. It was against their law to communicate to an indicted war criminal. Look, Putin is a prospective war criminal. He's brought Russian forces into Ukraine, seized territory in violation of international law. He's supporting the war in Donbas. I mean, I think OSCE is fine, but you got to get it to the United Nations. Whether it sticks or not is irrelevant. People have to hear the right of self-defense and the obligations of other nations to assist those who are being threatened. That's what I would say.
Remarkable. Mikhaila, you had something to add there.
Yeah, if I can add as well, I think General Clark hit the nail on the head when it comes to Putin as a war criminal. That's why a lot of initiatives in Congress actually to designate Russia as a state sponsor of terror. I think that also says a lot in terms of not just the person, but also the country and the country as he is leading it. So it's not just one person, but obviously it's the whole kit and caboodle, as they say. But also interesting in terms of the question that was raised on how do we provide any type of advocacy to the White House? Yes, obviously, just like we do with Congress, letters, signing onto the White House website, contacting the White House through mail and or email, or even by telephone is very important. But let's not forget that these bills that were mentioned earlier, a lot of them are authorization bills, meaning that the president is authorized and he has the capacity to do something. But with authorization also comes congressional oversight. And therefore, that's where we as a large Ukrainian community and our friends in Central and East, other European communities come into play here. Because in our interaction with our elected officials, it behooves us to make sure that those elected officials contact said administration and whichever departments and how that money is being authorized and how that money is being distributed. So it works both ways. We can go directly to the White House, but also we have another avenue, and that is through our friends in Congress.
I think also the fact that what we have demonstrated today, looking at who logged on today, who registered for this event, we had a plurality of states represented, upwards of 26. By my count of people who had registered to watch this. Other people will watch it online. So we know that there are Ukrainians in all those states who are interested in becoming active in this regard. We can only hope that they come away from this, from Dr. Karber's stern yet attaboy attitude about let's getting involved in this. And really thinking about whether you're working in a partisan campaign and want to join a campaign and help out and get the word out about Ukraine, or whether you're doing some advocacy, trying to remember Ronald Reagan's 11th commandment or the Ukrainian translation, which is Svida Svoha, and we make sure that we know who the one enemy is and it's not your fellow Ukrainian. To get back to what General Clark said, yes, there is an enormous amount of activity done at the United Nations that we should be pressing. There was just a vote by the General Assembly, again, dealing with the human rights situation in Crimea, and Ukraine once again got a majority of those votes. 65 nations voted for that. There were a number of nations who weren't present. A very small number of authoritarian regimes voted with Russia against that. One thing that you don't see very often is the ARIA formula session that Russian Federation did, trying to slam Ukraine as a hotbed of extremism. What you rarely see is the response by 40 member nations of the United Nations who signed onto a joint statement condemning this kind of activity because it makes a mockery of the United Nations Security Council. I know there were questions about the United Nations Security Council. I know that the former ambassador, Yelchenko, submitted an article to our Ukrainian quarterly saying, how Russia seized UCCR's UN seat. I think if you go through the remarks of the current ambassador of Ukraine to the United Nations, you'll hear during that vote that I just mentioned, 65 nations voting in favor of Ukraine, you'll hear him bring up the fact that, yes, in fact, Russia does have that seat illegally, according to the statute of the UN, and that it should have gone through the formal process of getting that seat as a new nation, as opposed to Ukraine, which was one of the founding members, even though it was a Ukrainian SSR. So, Mykolu and Mykhailo, I see a lot of questions here that I've copied and saved. A lot of them seem to be questions that we can answer perhaps in a further session. And with the accedence of both of you, and perhaps inviting some of our guests back for another round at some point, this is a conversation, as General Clark said, that is not ending anytime soon. Right, Michael?
Ongoing. And will be for 2022.
So,
yes.
So if I could.
Yes, Doctor.
So it was asked about the information access. We're in the process of putting together this information. It's still, like I said, a moving train, and we got much more work to do. But the UCCA will make it available in several weeks when we've put it together, and be and not only have all the charts you saw, but footnotes and documented and so forth. So be much more in depth. So those who are interested can have it for a reference, and then also share with others. If I could add one other thing to what we're talking about, what needs to be done. There's not been a U.S. ambassador in Ukraine for now 2 years. And you go, what the hell? Keith Dayton was scheduled. He was selected or went through his committee review, but then and was not 100% endorsement. Was not particularly a partisan kind of guy, but if there's one thing that Ukraine needs, it needs an American representative in Ukraine. Also, there was an American representative who was on the NATO Advisory Committee, chair of the NATO Advisory Committee, and that's also not a filled. So those are things that just need to get done. And I don't know why the administration is slow or whether they're having trouble getting their appointments through, but this is one that both sides of the aisle ought to say it's in the national interest to do. And by the way, I don't think it should be just another foreign service person who, you know, goes out and makes nice speeches and passes out flowers and candy. It ought to have someone with a security background so they know and can report back seriously what was happening.
I believe both of you gentlemen knew General Dayton, and with the support of our good friend Senator Portman from Ohio, UCCA actually entered a recommendation into that committee hearing that you mentioned, Doctor. He did pass out a committee, but the clock ran out as far as getting him appointed, which is unfortunate. But again, somebody with a security background, phenomenal. And we've always had somebody who shoots straight down the middle, not a partisan person, and that really helps out.
Thank you,
Dr. General Clark. Would you like any other words before Mikola and Michael and I speak a little bit more about coming to terms with what the next steps are?
Thanks very much. For giving me a chance to express my concerns. Look, the most important thing at this stage is the information battle. And it's not getting the attention it needs in the press. It's simply a matter of fact. If this were Israel and Israel were under this kind of threat, I promise you there'd be headlines every day. There'd be tens of thousands of letters written to congressmen. And it would be much different. So I agree with what Dr. Carver said about this being so important to the United States and our future and to NATO. We want to deter Putin. We want to convince him that he cannot succeed in discombobulating NATO by attacking Ukraine. And that is what I perceive the intent to be. So that deterrent requires active information at this time to build resistance among the American people, to build understanding among the American people of what this is like. Remember that in the United States, we've always had a certain fondness for Russian music, the Bolshoi Ballet, and then after the fall of the wall, of course, there's a flood of Russian money invested in the West. There are Russian businesses, there's Russian oligarchs over here, Wall Street, the city are suffused with Russian money. They influence major chains. Fox News apparently doesn't believe Ukraine's worth fighting for. And so any of your viewers who are, you know, ardent Fox viewers, you need to express your outrage at Tucker Carlson and the Fox editorial team who want to turn a blind eye to what Putin is threatening. But this is the kind of stuff that we need to see happening now to be able to get American foreign policy on the right course. We can't handle China if we lose Europe. Ukraine is part of that European package. We need to hold firm and stand fast. And to do that, we need public understanding. And 2 million Ukrainian Americans can help generate that.
General Clark, I can't thank you enough for taking part in this. And your words really resonate with me. I'm sure they're resonating with our audience who has submitted so many questions. Again, I'm documenting these questions, so we will make sure that we get to them. If not in this session, hopefully in a future webinar for other people. But with that, if your household is anything like mine, you've gotten a couple of side eyes from people wondering how late are you going to go into the night? So I'd like to wish you a very happy holiday. And a Merry Christmas, as some Ukrainians will still be celebrating in January. And thank you very much for all of your effort. And we hope to see you not just the information that you're passing along, but maybe in a future hearing in Capitol Hill. Hopefully we can get that information directly to the people and generate some press that way.
That'd be great.
Great.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with this group. Thank you, Andriy.
Thank you. Have a good night, General.
Thank you, Mykola.
All right. Mykola, like I said, we've been here for 2 hours, so I don't want to get anybody in trouble. And I know that children need to go to sleep. But given that fact, Mykola, first of all, I'd like to underscore the fact that not only are you here as the president of the Organization for Defense of for Freedoms of Ukraine, but you're also a board member of some of the other organizations that are featured. Dr. Karber, as well as General Clark. And we must thank the fact that the Ukrainsky Amerikansky Fond Voli is funding some of the research being done. Mykola, I know that it's always of benefit working with Mykola on Capitol Hill and the Center for U.S. Ukrainian Relations, connecting people on Capitol Hill, and most importantly, I believe, Mykola, is what is the benefit of members of Congress actually traveling to Ukraine? Even during this COVID time, we saw a couple of people coming over. I know you've been over in Ukraine with delegations. Can you just comment on how important that's going to be going forward, of people visiting the front line, or maybe even visiting that Florida National Guard that is currently stationed in Yavoriv?
All of this is very important because, as General Clark was saying, the information war is very important. And when you bring people over to Ukraine, and they meet with the soldiers, they meet with the people who are in the political leadership, they meet with people who are in civil society, they get a sense of what Ukraine is all about. It was a very important, we did through the Center for U.S. Ukrainian Relations together with the American Foreign Policy Council. We did several of these delegations. One was in 2017, and Andriy Futey was part of that group. And at that time, the president was Donald Trump. And we brought a group of people from think tanks that are on the Republican side. And they met with government leaders, and they came back, and they some of these people every week they were going to the National Security Council and talking to them about how Ukraine needs to be supported. And four or five months later, after that trip, the first lethal aid went to Ukraine, the Javelin rockets, and then later this past year, I was on a trip to Ukraine with a gentleman, Alex Gray. He was the chief of staff of the National Security Council during the Trump administration. And he was one of the persons that the people that we had on our trip would meet with all the time. And he played a very key role in making that happen. And that broke that wall where Ukraine wasn't getting any lethal aid. So these trips are very important because the people go on these trips, they come back and they talk. One of the gentlemen on the trip, this last trip that we're on, he said, I was at the airport with him, JFK, we're flying out to Ukraine. He goes, I want to see if the Ukrainians are going to fight. You know, because I'm not sure if they're going to fight. You know, he went, we were in Mariupol, we were in Shirok, you know. He comes back and he says, these soldiers remind me of the soldiers that are on the Golan Heights, the Israeli soldiers on the Golan Heights. They're ready. They know that they have a tough time and they're willing to fight. That's the biggest thing that I'm coming back with, is that they're willing to fight. And these kind of messages filter through. So these kind of trips are very important. The co-delegations are extremely important. And we see the support that Ukraine has right now. You know, there's several co-dels that Senator Portman was involved with, Senator Shaheen. These senators have a very large Ukrainian American and Eastern European constituency in their states. And they come back and they talk and they meet and they write articles. These are very important things. And we have to remember that Joe Biden and John Kerry, who seems to be calling the shots in foreign policy, they themselves were senators. So it's important that their former colleagues talk to them. And it's extremely, it was extremely brilliant move, the op-ed of Portman and Shaheen, and the fact that President Zelensky met with congressmen and senators a few days ago. And I know UKAKA had a very big hand in this. You know,
thank you for reminding me. I'm going to put that on the list of things to send out in the thank you email. We'll put a link to that article and a PDF version of that. If people haven't seen a bipartisan op-ed that was written in support of Ukraine, one of the co-founders of the Senate Ukraine Caucus and a vice chair of the Senate Ukraine Caucus writing publicly, again, language that you would expect the Ukrainian to say. This is how strong some of the arguments are. Michael, I believe that on the same day that UCCA put out their statement following the Biden-Putin call, the Congressional Ukraine Caucus put out a statement normally diplomatically, you don't see a letter coming out saying stingers, javelins coming out. And this is co-signed bipartisan by the Congressional Ukraine Caucus. So I'd just like to ask you about, you know, future letters that we think are coming through following on the CODELs. But given Mykola's conversation about the importance of CODELs, one of the first things that UKAKA will write to any presidential administration, and I know we did that with President Biden, who has received 5 letters from UCCA since the beginning, since his election, one of the first things we ask for is a visit to Ukraine. Can you remind us, please, when that last happened, that a sitting president actually visited Ukraine?
Thanks for the question. And I'd just like to accentuate again the advocacy that is absolutely positively necessary right here. It is 2 million Ukrainian Americans, but all of our friends as well and other Central and East European communities. Together, we amass basically between 20 to 25 million Americans of Central and East European descent. That is a fortuitous, I would say, number of voters and in very key states, as was mentioned by one of our previous speakers. So with all of this, obviously, is just the outlook and how we are to voice these concerns to our elected officials, whether it is to our friends in Congress or obviously to the administration. Looking at the administration, it's always difficult to forecast when a president will visit any particular country. I think right now, what I had heard over the Christmas holiday is a forecast for 2022 for President Biden and his particular foreign travels include Latin America and Africa. Unfortunately, Europe was not on the map, no pun intended, but therefore it doesn't mean that it won't be an opportunity for President Biden to go to Ukraine. But I also think that this would be beholden upon us to make sure that the administration understands the necessity for a sitting American president to travel to Ukraine and to meet with the sitting Ukrainian president. So it's not just a symbolic gesture. This goes in terms of the strategic partnership which exists between the two countries. And having as many congressional delegations, CODELs as they're called, going to Ukraine also helps to accentuate that within any said administration, that as bipartisan CODELs are going to Ukraine, hopefully, an administration and the president of the United States will go as well.
And just when you're pointing out that the trips are likely as being Latin America and or Africa, the kind of advocacy that happens in Washington, D.C. isn't necessarily, he can just take a direct flight there. We talk to people in the White House, we talk to people in Congress, we try to find out when there is a possibility of something happening in Europe, right, Michael? So that if there is a trip to the Baltics, like President Obama did to Estonia, this is when you'll get a lot of phone calls from Otsusiuti, from Young Sumiuti or Plastudy even, our Ukrainian American veterans. We put that word out as soon as we know that, say, President Trump is traveling to Warsaw. That is a quick hop and a jump from Yavoriu. And that's when we try to flood the phones. So even though we know that the big trips of Latin America and Africa are coming, there will be summits, there will be a G20, there will be a G7 coming up at some point, and that's when we will try to get a trip towards Ukraine. I do want to remind everybody that we're now at the plus 2 hour plus meeting. So with that in mind, Mykolo and Mykhaila, I know that Andriy Futey couldn't be with us today. We did have that video greeting at the beginning. I know he'd like to be involved in another one of these group discussions with some other people. Mykhaila, you are a very active member of the Central and Eastern European Coalition in Washington, D.C. There's been a lot of mention of other ethnic communities here in this country. Perhaps we can reach out to some of them about doing a group discussion like this and maybe introducing some of these questions, because some of these questions really don't relate to Ukraine or the United States directly. Some of them are like, what happens, what do the Baltic nations think about doing some stuff on their own, or Poland? We do know that we have very active representation that we saw in the recent Polish-American Congress statement, given what's happening in Ukraine. So perhaps we can reach out a little bit more. Mykolo, Mykhaila, is that something we can tentatively promise some of our participants today in the future?
I think, you know, years ago, we used to have the Captive Nations Committee. You know, we have the organization that we're involved with in Washington, the Central and East European Coalition, but that's a Washington-based organization. And we have, right now online, we have activists from across several states. And years ago, the Captive Nations Committees, they were local, they were grassroots. We need to reach out to our local Eastern European compatriots and reform these coalitions on a local level.
Mykolo,
I think that's a very important thing.
I think you know, once you took over as the Holova of Ochus, you know that during this COVID time, this is how we do it.
Maybe
less travel expenses, but if you're ready for it, we can go on a virtual road trip. So
we've learned how to use Zoom, because Zoom existed for years, but we've learned how to use it. Nobody used it before it. So we're all experts.
But
I just want to say one thing. You know, we still need to. You know, we have you know, 200 people registered. We have people on YouTube. We have a whole group of people in Buffalo in their hall watching us. People in New York watching us at the New York Hall at our ODFFU building. Biden's going to be meeting with Putin on January 10th.
Yeah.
If we could flood the White House with emails and letters between now and then, saying to support Ukraine, to release that military aid, you know, the op-ed that you spoke about that Portman and Shaheen wrote, that's our message. That's a very succinct way. They put it succinctly what our message is. We don't have to sit there and think about what we're going to say. They said it for us. We just need to read it and repeat it. And it's very easy to get onto the to write an email to the White House. It takes 2-3 clicks off of your phone. I was experimenting with it before our meeting today. It took me, I don't know, 5 seconds to get onto the page where you write an email. And if all our activists that are on board right now can do that tonight or tomorrow and ask all their people in their communities, the other activists that couldn't make it and mobilize this, you know, we could have several thousand emails in a matter of 15 days or how many ever days we have left, 12 days till the 10th. You know, and that's something, and that's a reachable goal, and that's something that we should say to ourselves that we're going to do that tonight. You know, because right now is the time for maximum effort, because the last time Ukrainians lost the war with the Russians 10 years later in 1932, we had a genocide. Reading what Putin wrote these past few months, you know he's getting ready to wipe us off the face of the earth.
Well, he's already doing it in Russia with our Ukrainian communities there. So he's doing it
to the Crimean Tatars. We're watching a genocide of the Crimean Tatars right now. You know, and we need to stop that. And we need to stop the future genocide of Ukrainians, because that's our history. That's what's happened. You know, so that's now's the time for maximum effort. So that's
emailing,
it out of me.
Emailing the White House. We have 2 weeks until that meeting, and that happens through the White House website because that's how they log it all in. You don't have to look for a specific email. You just go to the website itself, and that's the same thing, Mikhaila, when I ask you how to contact your representatives in on Capitol Hill, the Senate.gov website, that will let you find your senator, and on their website itself is where you register the email. Same thing for a member of Congress. I know that General Clark tried to get us to get some more press. Mikhaila mentioned that next year is an election year. There are already declared candidates. If there is a major Putin news event between Biden and Putin, get a comment from either a sitting member of Congress or any other candidate for official, and you turn to the other candidate and say, this candidate said this. What do you say about Putin and how you're going to help Ukraine? So we do have a couple of weeks to get that press that General Clark said. We do have all the information that, again, following this webinar, we will be emailing out all this information. And I think we have at least a loose agreement that we do need to continue these conversations. And so I'd like to thank Mikhaila both for your participation and your spurring of this as a representative of the Organization for Defense of Four Freedoms of Ukraine, one of the co-sponsors of this event. Mikhaila, thank you so much for that thorough summary. Again, we can send those infographics that you've made up and you send on a regular basis out for all the bills. We'll send that out as well so people know what bills. And I know for me, the easiest way is just going to the Congress website, congress.gov. If you put the number of the bill you saw in Mikhaila's infographic, you will get not only the text of the bill, but who has co-sponsored it, at what committee it's sitting, who's voted on it, yes or no. So you can find out all that information online. We'll try to make that easier for you. And in closing, because I haven't done enough of this, I'd really like to thank, first of all, everybody who took part in this as participants. For those of you who took time to do this, this is incredibly important. And as I mentioned earlier, we saw registrations from over 26 states, and those are Ukrainian names on those lists. And we urge you to get involved, not just making sure that people know what Ukraine is, but see about getting involved politically, be involved as an activist, and see how that works. I'd like to thank all of the member organizations pictured behind me of the Ukrainian Congress Committee, who I saw participating in the Ukrainian American Bar Association, which, Victor, you always send such great questions in, and we're going to follow up on those. We had members of our Sumiuti sending in questions, the Women's Associations for the Defense of Four Freedoms. I saw some of our Ukrainian American veterans on as well. I can't thank all of you enough for continuing to be politically active. But as far as the organizations who put this together, Mikhaila, the Ukrainian National Information Service does have a separate page on the UCCA website. Right at the top, you can find the archives of a lot of the action alerts that Mikhaila puts out. follow some of those archive links and make sure in the information that we send out to you, if you want to sign up for Mikhailo's updates, he does send out action alerts. And UNIS, as UKAKA, as all these co-sponsoring organizations, is a non-for-profit. So we do ask during this time of giving, if you're so inclined, all this advocacy is tax deductible, as all of these are 501c3 organizations, and all of this helps us advocacy going forward. We have done so much as a community, millions and millions of dollars in terms of humanitarian aid. We also thank you for the aid that you give to these nonprofits. And so in addition to the Ukrainian National Information Service, UCCA at ucca.org, you'll find information for donating online, or you can donate through check in or through our national office here. And Mikhailo has the office in Washington, D.C. Mikhailo, the Organization for Defense of Four Freedoms of Ukraine, is also a registered 501c3 organization. That means donations to them during this time of giving are appreciated and also tax deductible. The Ukrainian American Freedom Foundation, Ukrainska Amerikanska Fundacja Vola, sent out its annual Kolada. You can also support that. That is a great resource for this Ukrainian American community that, as I mentioned, made sure that Dr. Karber got some of those funds to make sure that he can prepare that report. And lastly, the Center for U.S. Ukrainian Relations will be having another conference about national security of Ukraine, security concerns, the state of the military, and that will be coming up in February and March. Hopefully we can have an online discussion before then. But again, for those of you who are so inclined, we thank you for your support by being in attendance. If you are able to contribute during this time of giving, we very much appreciate that. But our gift to you will be continuing working for Ukraine, continuing for our community, and making sure that your opinions are voiced in Congress or to your local elected officials. If you have a local community that's locally that's active locally and has issues communicating with their congressman, oftentimes you can contact the national office, which you can find on UCCA website, or contact Mikhailo. And we can push from the Washington side and say, hey, we have a local community over in, I know we've done this for Minneapolis, we've done this for communities in California and Oregon and Washington State, communities that may not be connected as much with some of our community, but we are always ready to help out in terms of making sure that your local advocacy gets heard in the White House. This is a time of giving. So one last time, I will thank you for all the donations that you have bestowed richly this season, but we can always do with some more. I would like to wish all of you a happy new year, all of you a very Merry Christmas, and all of you great wishes in your endeavors of continuing your advocacy. You have been so active, so vocal for over 7 years now. United States law has been changed because of your advocacy. But as Mikhailo said, this is a very critical time. As Michael said, this is a time where we can actually influence legislation that's on the docket right now. We can get more co-sponsors for that legislation. As Dr. Karber said, why is it that we can't organize together and just get that political momentum to finally get Russia to get the message that they need to get out of Ukraine? And as General Clark said, it's only with all of your support that we can do this. So thank you once again. Thank you, Mikhailo. Mikhailo, if you would like to say any other words, I know that there are a bunch of people who have already texted me, good night, what a wonderful program.
I just like to, if anything, make a closing remark on behalf of the Ukrainian Congress Committee of America, as Vice President, as well as the Director of Ukrainian National Information Service. This is community led. Everything that we're doing is community led. Everything that we do in terms of advocacy and the initiatives throughout our communities and in Washington in particular stems from you, stems from the community. So think of UNIS as the clearinghouse of information, with information from the community going through the office to members of Congress and vice versa, information from Congress through the office that goes to the community. So this advocacy is a two-way street. and it is absolutely necessary to get as many people involved as possible. So we are working very closely with our Central and East European colleagues within various communities, as well as reaching out to others. There are other organizations, there are other groups that are very mindful of the situation in Ukraine right now, and they're looking forward to helping us as well. So I look forward to everyone's participation in 2022. As I had mentioned earlier, if you receive any type of information from us, please don't just keep it in your email, send it out to others. Make sure that there are as many people as possible within your close circle of friends, relatives, and family members that obviously can help the situation and help the initiatives as much as possible. So again, thank you. Thanks to everyone, to the audience members for all of their participation, listening to the wonderful presentations by Dr. Karber and Dr. Karber, as well as to General Clark. They were truly fascinating, informative, extremely thorough, and just gives us that much more of a mindset and gives us that much more of an impetus to continue our work within the Ukrainian community. So thank you. And on behalf of the UCCA, on behalf of Eunice, wishing you a very healthy and happy and safe 2022 for us as a community, for the United States, as well as for Ukraine.
There's some questions in the Q&A asking if we're going to be sending templates out of the various letters to the White House and all. Yes, they will be going out tomorrow. I've already spoke with Andriy about this, and they'll be going out tomorrow and the day after. And there's a lot of stuff that's already prepared that Mykhailo had prepared through Eunice. So.
Right. If you again, if you're on Mykhailo's mailing list, you will have received numerous sample letters. Some of those can be found right now if you go to ucca.org/Eunice. Those archived appeals by Mykhailo. But I will send you Zoom will send you a thank you for attending tomorrow. And in that email, we will send links for any of these archived things, including. I believe General Clark said something about what you saw on certain news stations. We do have a two-pager about how to react to a news station saying something that they shouldn't be saying about Ukraine. Any of this kind of information that you can use for yourself for advocacy, it's for you to be doing that. So absolutely, we'll follow up on that 100%. Mykhailo, did you want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas, or
yes,
am I going to see you again this week?
For everybody who celebrated on the 25th, Merry Christmas, Veselich Shat. Christmas is still coming up for some of us who celebrate the old calendar. So I wish you all Veselich Shat and everybody Happy New Year.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Again, you'll be getting something in your inbox tomorrow. Thank you, Mykhailo. Thank you, Mykhailo. And thank you for all of you for taking part.
Take care. Dobranoc.